So we're honored to have as our next speaker, Mr. Joseph Chen, who is the Undersecretary for the Financial Services and the Treasury for the Hong Kong government. And he will join us now, Mr. Chen.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to be here today to spend the next 15 minutes to share with you the government's view and commitment in fintech industry, and also the way we see the development of virtual assets as well. To begin with, I want to recap that Hong Kong is Asia's leading international financial center. When we say that, we don't take that sentence lightly. If you look at the equity markets, right, the turnover of equity market last year in terms of daily traded volume went up by 29% on a year-on-year basis. If you look at the bond market, we rank number one in terms of Asian international bond arrangement in Asia. If you look at insurance, we rank number one in Asia, number two in the world in terms of insurance density. If you look at cross-border wealth management center by AUM, we also rank number one in Asia, number two in the world, just trailing by Switzerland, which by that same BCG report, we were projected to take over next year as well. So that's who we are. And why it is important to fintech is because, why it's important to Hong Kong as well is because from Hong Kong perspective, we need to maintain our market share across all those segments. But the development of fintechs is indeed already changing the landscape. So we need to embrace the change to ensure we protect our current market share and even gain more market share in the future. So that's why fintech is very high in our priorities under the current administration. And we intend to develop fintech by enhancing our infrastructure, by building a more active fintech ecosystem, nurturing talents, and strengthening connection and collaboration with the mainland and overseas markets as well. When I talk about infrastructure, of course, I need to touch first on the faster payment system. It was launched back in 2018, so the usage of FPS has continued to grow since then with its instant payment and transfer functionalities expanded to promote adoption of electronic payment. It now not only supports P2P payments, but also merchant payments, account top-up, and also payment of government bills and fees using QR code, etc. At the end of last year, actually, we see that the total number of registrations already reached 9.8 million. And as of last month, it already exceeded 10 million of registration out of our population. It's only 7.4 million, as you know. We also observe an average daily real-time transactions over 860,000 transactions per day as well. So indeed, it has developed very quickly. Talking about financial infrastructure, another piece that I definitely would like to touch on is the CDI, Commercial Data Interchange. So this is a platform, a centralized platform, that enterprises can authorize service providers such as payment systems, public bodies, or utility companies to furnish the banks with data. It is a infrastructure being built by the Hong Kong Monetary Authority. The banks can then conduct more accurate and objective credit risk assessment to enhance trade finance efficiency, thereby reducing the need for enterprises to provide collateral and facilitating SMEs in obtaining trade finance. The CDI is in pilot launch stage at the moment, involving 8 pairs of banks and data providers. New use cases are being explored with additional data providers and technology service providers involved. The official launch of CDI expected by the end of this year. A number of banks have already successfully approved loans totaling over 900 million Hong Kong dollars to SMEs using various kinds of commercial data during the study and the pilot launch stages of this project. And the HKMA will enrich the data-driven financial service ecosystem by exploring the introduction of more commercial data sources in order to expand the function of CDI. In order to take forward the strategy of opening up government data in a more holistic manner, The Office of the Government Chief Information Officer will also explore the development of a standardized API to enable sharing of data by more government departments through the CDI, thereby building it into a new financial infrastructure in Hong Kong. When we talk about financial infrastructure, we also have seen blockchain technology being applied in financial infrastructures as well. One of them is Midas, which is actually a motor insurance blockchain-based system. What it does is that it's actually help reduce the risk of frauds and also help improve the efficiency in terms of approving the insurance claims or so. And it's actually the development of such was supported by various government departments, including the transport department, the police, and also the financial services and the treasury bureau. Another example of using blockchain to develop financial structure in Hong Kong is the E-Trade Connect, which is the first large-scale cross-bank blockchain-based trade finance platform initiated by the HKMA, jointly developed by major banks in Hong Kong and operated by the Hong Kong Trade Finance Platform Company Limited. Since its official launch back in 2018, E-Trade Connect strives to enhance the efficiency, transparency, and security of trade finance through digitalization of paper documents to effectively reduce the financing cost of SMEs and improve the trust between banks and SMEs by minimizing the risks of duplicated financing by banks due to human errors. In addition to local application of E-Trade Connect, there has also been cross-boundary application of E-Trade Connect as well. Phase 1 and Phase 2 connectivity between the People's Bank of China Trade Finance Platform and Hong Kong's E-Trade Connect were successfully completed, providing more convenient trade finance services and financial products. Banks in Hong Kong and mainland are now using the connected trade platforms to execute more cross-boundary trade finance transactions. Talking about cross-boundary businesses, of course, we want to promote more fintech projects for cross-boundary use. And to achieve that, in order to achieve that, the HKMA and the PBOC signed a MOU in October last year on linking up the PBOC's FinTech Innovation Regulatory Facility with Hong Kong MA's FinTech Supervisory Sandbox in the form of a network. This initiative seeks to provide a one-stop platform for financial institutions and technology companies to conduct pilot trials of cross-border fintech initiatives concurrently in Hong Kong and other Greater Bay Area cities in the mainland, thereby allowing them to obtain feedback from regulators and users earlier, expediting the launch of fintech products and lowering the development costs. The HKMA and the PBOC have finalized the implementation details to operationalize this one-stop platform. And in February this year, invitations were sent to financial institutions and tech firms for pilot trials of this cross-boundary fintech initiatives platform. And over 20 FIs have expressed interest to test their projects through this network. Of course, when we talk about fintech and we touch on blockchain early as well, one area that of interest, of course, to the audience today is about the regulation on virtual assets as well. One of our regulatory measures is to establish a licensing regime for virtual asset service providers in the light of the new requirement imposed by the Financial Action Task Force under G20. And under this licensing regime, this proposed licensing regime, which will be implemented through amending our existing anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing ordinance, all virtual asset exchanges are required to apply for a license from the SFC before providing services in Hong Kong. Both securities type virtual assets and non-securities virtual assets are subject to the licensing regime. It is our regulatory philosophy that virtual asset exchanges should be subject to the same requirements and obligations which currently apply to traditional FIs in such area in the name of anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing, as well as investor protection, to ensure consistencies across our regulations. besides taking into consideration the fact that virtual asset trading is a technology-driven industry, requirements will be imposed to address potential risks such as system failures and cybersecurity. In drawing up the details of the legislative proposal, we conducted a public consultation with the conclusion released in May last year. We also briefed the panel on financial affairs of the Legislative Council in February this year. Based on the views gathered from LegCo and the public consultation, we are now preparing legislative amendments with the aim of introducing an amendment bill to LegCo later this year. Those who are interested may refer to the paper that we submitted to LegCo, and it's a good starting point for getting to understand this proposal. We believe that a clear regulatory regime will build up market confidence and hence provide clarity and certainty for the virtual assets sustainable development in Hong Kong. Of course, in addition to virtual assets trading platform, the other item always being touched on it's e-Hong Kong dollar, central bank digital currency. The HKMA is currently examining the feasibility of issuing retail-level central bank digital currency in Hong Kong, that is Hong Kong dollar, covering both technical and policy consideration. It actually published a technical white paper in October last year to elaborate on the technical design and invite the academia and industry to submit comments. It expects to come up with an initial view on EHKD in the middle of this year. In terms of CBDC, the HKMA is also studying both the wholesale level and retail level in depth with other locations as well. The HKMA, together with three central banks, namely the Digital Currency Institute of PBOC, the Bank of Thailand, and the Central Bank of the UAE, as well as the Bank for International Settlements, BIS Innovation Hub Hong Kong Centre, are conducting a project named Multiple CBDC Bridge, MBridge. The project seeks to conduct in-depth analysis of the functions of the DLT in facilitating conduct of real-time cross-border foreign exchange payments versus payment transactions in a multi-jurisdictional context and on a round-the-clock basis, as well as the cases for relevant business use. The HKMA, together with the participating authorities of the project, have early identified 15 potential business use cases and selected the function of international trade settlement for testing on a trial platform. The test has proved that MBridge can enhance the efficiency of cross-border payments while ensuring appropriate mechanisms are in place for complying with the relevant policy, regulatory, and privacy protection requirements. We expect the function of international trade settlement under MBridge will enter the pilot stage this year with the aim to develop a system that could support the full process of international trade settlement. On the other hand, we note that the PBOC has indicated that ECNY would mainly be used for retail payments. In fact, renminbi is already in use in Hong Kong, and the status of ECNY is the same as cash in circulation. Its usage will offer an additional means which is safe, convenient, and innovative for cross-boundary retail consumption to residents in Hong Kong and mainland. It will also enhance the efficiency and user experience of cross-boundary payment services, helping to promote mutual access in the Guangdong-Hong Kong-Macau Greater Bay Area and supporting the consolidation of Hong Kong status as a global offshore renminbi business hub. The HKMA and the Digital Currency Institute of PBOC completed the first phase of technical testing of using ECNY for making cross-boundary payments in Hong Kong already. The HKMA is currently discussing with the PBOC the next phase of the technical testing, including the involvement of more banks in Hong Kong and using the faster payment system to top up ECNY wallets as well. In addition, the industry is also, of course, looking into the development of stablecoins. The HKMA issued a discussion paper on stablecoins in January this year, setting out the HKMA's thinking on the relevant regulatory approach for crypto assets, particularly payment-related stablecoins, and the consultation was ended in March this year. The HKMA proposed adopting a risk-based, pragmatic, and agile regulatory approach. The HKMA is analyzing the feedback received at the moment, and it will also take into account the developments in the major jurisdictions and the international regulatory communities before mapping out the next steps in due course. Ladies and gentlemen, to provide a conducive environment for fintech development is more than just financial infrastructures and regulations, but also involve other elements such as nurturing talents and also building an active ecosystem, as I mentioned at the outset. Although I understand that I'm already exceeding the 15 minutes limit, so I'll just touch on those items very quickly. We will launch a new round of the FinTech Proof of Concept Subsidy Scheme this year to encourage the financial sector to conduct proof of concept on more FinTech solutions and products. We have rolled out a new round of the Financial Practitioners FinTech Training Program in February this year to provide FinTech training and subsidies for financial practitioners. In order to promote professional development of FinTech talent, we will also develop professional qualifications for FinTech practitioners, with the first batch related to the banking sector expected to be rolled out this year. We will launch the pilot scheme on training subsidies for FinTech practitioners to subsidize practitioners attaining FinTech professional qualifications. And of course, this list can go on and on, but what I want to share with you is that we are firmly committed to developing the FinTech business in Hong Kong, and we definitely have a wide range of measures supporting Seoul. Ladies and gentlemen, Hong Kong ranked number 3 in the world and number 1 in Asia under the Global Financial Center Index, just published in March this year. Globally, we're behind New York and London. What does that mean? That means, as a fintech company located in Hong Kong, you enjoy tremendous access to potential clients, potential business partners, and potential investors. On this note, I would once again welcome and encourage you all to make use of Hong Kong's platform to develop your fintech business, and the administration will continue to work closely with you to provide a conducive environment for your business. Thank you very much.